Anubis is basically just kind of a, has an Egyptian feel to it, and kind of have our own, formula for writing songs with the whole structure of everything. So when Tony and I wrote it, we basically just kind of sat down and solos, both the solos, we both have one, and it's just kind of, using different scales and stuff like that, and drums.
Yeah, we just wanted to go a little crazy. There's like little splash fills. It's actually one of our favorite songs to play. We actually play it first every night.
And then, as far as the lyrics, we called the song the Egyptian Metal Song. It's like its working title, and I wanted to build off of that, like, and keep that feel. So, the song's basically written in a metaphor. The person who's speaking, me, the first line is, I'm the king of the world. It's talking about an Egyptian king who's wanting to dominate, basically take over the world. In the verses, you can tell that, it's almost the king is very angry. And it's because he's talking to all the people who stand against the kingdom, which, in the metaphorical sense would be our band and our fans and the people who support us. And then the choruses, are noticeably more upbeat, and actually I think it's the only time on our CD we actually use a major chord. I think it's good. Well, I'm wrong, but it has a very more upbeat flow than a lot of other songs, and it's the king is talking to those who are in his kingdom, and his followers and supporters, and it's talking about them rallying together.
It was 2012 is actually a song that we co-wrote with Tom Diddy. He helped us out with co-releasing that song. We wanted something a little more straightforward and more of a breakdown feel. So we thought that we just make something crazy. We want to basically just a straightforward breakdown song with some really catchy set of parts.
It didn't need any very in-depth lyrical style to it. I feel because the song is, like Justin said, straightforward, and it's I wanted to write in a very blunt way. And the songs, it's heavy, and we recorded it in drop B, which is the lowest tuning song on the album. And I just wanted it to be heavy and just have that feel of brutal the whole time. And the choruses write a little bit darker than the other songs. So that song's, about, again, more of just a story of a person who's had their life taken away from them, and, they were left with nothing, and then they decide to come back and have revenge, on the person who, stole everything from them. So it's a very just brutal, straightforward song about how you feel if, someone were to basically steal everything, out from underneath you.
Dreamcatcher, we actually wrote, it was the last song we wrote on the CD, and we wrote it the night before, basically. I mean, the lyrics were already kind of written out, but we wrote it basically the night before the music. We went in for the first day of the studio, and it was kind of just more, one song we just, honestly, Tony and I just got together, and we just started jamming. That's basically what it sounds like when we jam. We kind of just didn't really do a whole lot of structure in that song. We just kind of wanted just have some cool chill parts. And that's why it starts out clean and more ambient, I guess. But we wrote that one with just me, Tony, and Justin. It was all practice pads and practice amps. It's jamming in with your lyrics and everything.
Yeah, that song, it came together super fast. I remember when they were just playing and writing, it was just it's one of those things that sometimes when they write together, especially with Zach and Tony, since they've been playing guitar together off and on for 5 years, and what a lot of people notice, like, with our debut album, is, like, the chemistry that we have as guitar players, and I think Dreamcatcher is a really good example, especially if you know, like, how fast it was written, of, like, their chemistry together.
And we're in, like, an hour.
Yeah, it's literally...
It's just, like, a dance.
Yeah, just jamming. Yeah, it just came together, and, like, I was sitting there, and I was finishing up different lyrics for other things, and I'm listening to it, and, like, just overall, like, I was just feeling that song, and even as, like, vocals go, like, I wanted to feel more like a jam song, like how they were, like, I wanted it to have that vibe, and, you know, it's so just, like, soothing, like,
it's definitely one of my favorite songs on the CD,
and then you hit the chorus, and then, you know, then it just comes in, and then all of a sudden it's just, like, really fast, and it's, heavy, and so I think that song shows, like, it's almost like polar opposites within one song. It shows, like, one side of us, and then it can show, like, the next, but it, like, flows. It's like, it, you know, almost comes together, like, you know, an outward, where it just, like, all of a sudden meets this peak, and, like, then it just doesn't really let up for the whole rest of the song. It actually has some of my favorite riffs, you know, off the album in that song. We actually had kind of a bad experience with past management, and we were in between wanting to make a change that, you know, could help, you know, push the band in the right direction and take us to the next level. And our best friends and became as Romans are managed by Hourly Management, and they're co-managed by Mike Mallory and Matthew Stewart, who are now our managers. And they just spoke so highly of them, and not just business-wise, but just how they've had a personal, challenge to themselves to try and do the best they can for the band, because they actually, you know, care about us, not as just a band, but as, you know, the individuals that make up the band. And that, like, really impressed us a lot. Nothing against any other managers or anything, like, especially Artery, they're
just
great.
Just happy with our manager?
Yeah, like, they're a great management company, and they're obviously doing something right because so many bands work with them, but we just wanted a little bit more personal attention, and, you know, we were offered that, and so it's definitely a must to have managers, you know, in what you do, are trustworthy and know what to do to put your band in the next level, so we're pretty fortunate. All right, the steps that we've taken and what a lot of bands take to try and get to the next level, obviously you have to practice a lot, you have to improve. Most bands can't get too far without talent. We've been blessed with some really talented musicians in the band. We have a great label who loves us, who pushes us. We have a great booking agent who's been there from day one, Jaden, with the agency group. We have, you know, management that we just talked about. When you have all those pieces and you have the constant urge to improve as a band, as, you know, not just your live sound, but your chemistry and the way you write music, and still maintain a very strong connection with fans, like, it's hard not to, you know, take steps forward, especially if that's what you're willing to sacrifice things in life for. We've all given up a lot to try and, you know, work harder and to be where we're at now. So I think, like, if you have the talent and you have the ability to sacrifice, you know, what's going to be a lot in your life, then you, especially with the team around you that's, you know, willing to push for your band, we've just been very fortunate and happy with everything. And things just keep progressing, so you just got to work hard. And I know that's kind of like a cliche answer, but the harder you work, then the band who's at the top, like, it's just going to help you get to there faster. So that's what the mindset we try and have is, you can't ever settle, you know, you can always do more. You know, there's always something that can be done every day to help your band. So we try and capitalize on as many of those things as we can.